Russian forces in Ukraine are building up concentrations of tanks, artillery and attack aviation in the Donbas region for a new large-scale offensive. For Ukraine, this is a daunting threat and one which they are struggling to acquire enough heavy weaponry and ammunition of all kinds to meet. However, for the Russian army this is in many ways a desperate move, doubling down with army units that have so far failed to achieve strategically decisive results and have taken brutal casualties in the process. The outcome of the coming offensive in the east of Ukraine will have huge implications for the nature of the rest of the war and how long it is likely to last. Let's take a short break with the sponsor of today's video, Ground News. This is the world's first news comparison platform. Every day we process more than 30,000 articles, gathering related stories in one place, so readers can see which media outlets are reporting on an issue and compare coverage in real time. In a sea of misinformation, we are really concerned about the future of news. Our website, apps and other tools are giving you the power to compare the news by swiping between headlines or get a breakdown that shows the ownership data of news sources reporting on a story. For example, if we see this story Finland to make decision on NATO entry in coming weeks not months. We can see that 18 news sources are reporting about this, from them, 5 are leaning left, 5 are leaning right and 3 are in the center. So the bias distribution is saying that 38% of the sources lean left and right, which is equal. With this simple tool you can see, is the story is someone's propaganda or relevant article. If you want to be well informed, then check in the link in the description, ground.news/warthog and download the free app to start think freely. Russia had massed approximately 190,000 troops for its full-scale invasion of Ukraine on February 24. More than 40,000 of these were second-line Rusguardia units, territorial defense troops who are not generally equipped or trained for frontline combat. The remaining 150,000 regular troops deployed were arranged into approximately 120 augmented battalion tactical groups out of the 168 BTGs, which the Russian army can theoretically generate for operations without national mobilization. For context, a Russian army BTG typically has around 10 tanks, 40 infantry fighting vehicles, and is composed of around 700 to 900 troops, and in combat operations, these numbers are typically bolstered by additional attached support elements. Since the invasion began, around 2,800 Russian vehicles have been visually confirmed as destroyed or captured, including 480 tanks and 850 infantry fighting vehicles, armored personnel carriers and armored fighting vehicles. Estimating the number of Russian troops lost is much more difficult, but NATO estimates in mid-March put the figure at between 7,000 to 15,000 killed in action. Even if the true figure in mid-March was closer to 7,000, it will be far higher now, since brutal fighting has continued for weeks since then, including the collapse and retreat of the two main northern axes of Russian advance on Kyiv. Retreating Russian forces will have taken particularly heavy casualties from Ukrainian artillery fire and continual ambushes along the few main routes available. As a general rule, in warfare total casualties, which includes troops who are badly wounded, captured or missing, tend to be 3 to 4 times those killed in action. Therefore, the total number of Russian casualties is likely to be at least 40,000 troops from their starting forces of around 190,000. It is small wonder then that a senior Western official suggested on Monday that 37 to 38 of the Russian BTGs deployed to Ukraine have taken such heavy losses as to now be combat ineffective. This is a huge proportion of the total forces available to the Russian army without full-scale national mobilization, something which is politically difficult for the Kremlin, which has so far sought to domestically portray its invasion of Ukraine as a special military operation. Furthermore, losses will have been disproportionately suffered by the frontline infantry and vehicle crews in Russian units, not the majority of support and logistics support personnel. Therefore, losses in terms of usable combat power are likely to be even more severe than they look on paper. These losses are critical to understanding the current offensive build-up in the Donbas. Russia cannot redeploy all of its remaining uncommitted BTGs to Ukraine as reinforcements to replace units mulled in the defeats north of Kyiv. It has to maintain serious forces to defend its NATO borders around the enclave of Kaliningrad and the Baltic states, as well as the border with Finland, and its overseas deployments in Syria and the occupied territories in Georgia and Moldova. The regular conscript rotation has also just occurred, meaning that unless the Kremlin declares a state of war and large-scale mobilization, it has to allow the previous crop of 130,000 conscripts to return home and start training the next intake. Conscripts are not legally eligible for service outside Russia in peacetime, and units formed primarily of conscripts will have even worse training and morale than regular forces have displayed in Ukraine. The fact that Russia is trying to rapidly refit and redeploy the units withdrawn from northern Ukraine to the Donbas immediately is a sign of a desperate shortage of other options. These units have been defeated, taken very heavy casualties and taken part in horrendous atrocities against civilians. They will not be combat effective in any normal sense of the term. The units they are reinforcing, which are already in the Donbas, have been in intense combat over 45 days and also taken heavy losses. Yet after its defeat in the north, the Kremlin needs a victory against Ukrainian forces in the east, and soon, so that they have something positive to spin in time for Victory Day on May 9. The question is, given the casualties suffered so far and their limited remaining regular forces which can be thrown into the upcoming offensive, can they generate a sufficient concentration of combat power at the critical points? The Ukrainian military has taken heavy losses too, although they are far less well documented. However, Ukrainian defenders are fighting with excellent morale and defense of their homeland, rather than trying to conduct offensive operations for constantly shifting justifications. In the Donbas, Ukrainian forces are occupying a series of well-fortified positions along the Donets River line and are being reinforced by units freed up by the Russian retreat from Kyiv, Chernihiv, and Sumy in the north. However, Ukraine is using ammunition, especially modern anti-tank weapons, faster than it is being delivered from the west. Continued resupply efforts are essential, as the munitions requirements to stop the coming offensive will be huge. Furthermore, while the defenders of Mariupol, besieged with almost no resupply or relief since the start of the invasion, have held on with absolutely astonishing tenacity and bravery, they are running out of ammunition in addition to food, water and medical supplies. An alleged chemical weapons attack on the remaining defenders has yet to be confirmed. It may well turn out to have been phosphorus or burning industrial chemicals as a result of unceasing Russian bombardments, rather than a nerve agent. However, either outcome should not obscure Russia's determination to finish off the defenders and the desperate situation for the Ukrainian troops there. Once Mariupol falls, the units besieging it will be free to join those massing for the wider Donbas offensive. All of this points to the coming Russian offensive being a decisive test for both sides. If Russia succeeds in breaking the Ukrainian defense lines in Donbas and encircling, or forcing a retreat by the Ukrainian Joint Forces Operations units there, then it will likely consolidate a new front line across most of Donetsk and Luhansk oblasts. This would set the stage for a long, drawn-out battle of attrition, as Ukraine will likely refuse to abandon its citizens to Russian atrocities and forced deportations in the occupied zone, but will struggle to break through consolidated Russian front lines. On the other hand, if Ukrainian forces manage to prevent the Russian offensive from achieving these goals and continue to inflict similar loss rates, then the Russian army in Ukraine will be a largely spent force, and we may see large-scale retreats comparable to those seen in the north as Ukrainian units go on the offensive against their supply lines in the northeast and southwest. Thanks for watching, and don't forget to subscribe. Also, if you want to support Warthog Defense, please become our member and get early access to new videos, exclusive members-only videos, and become administrator in comment section. The membership link is in the description.
Every day we had a guy last week at 6 rescues in 6 days. You know, he's doing the job every day.